Welcome everybody to the very last Kanon Book Club podcast. Here we are to discuss the Aye Root. I'm your host, Aspirety. Joining me today, we have Pepe.
Hello, hello, hello.
The Rational Pie.
Hey, hey.
And a guest I believe some of you may have been looking forward to, Kanon.
Hello!
As in, like, the person Kanon, not the game.
Yes,
no,
yes,
no,
yes.
The VN, it's the VN Kanon.
Yeah. I am the VN, I am from 1999. Please support the official release.
And Kanon, the visual novel, I believe you're here to do a 30-second recap of yourself, is that correct?
Well, I'm here to do a 30-second recap of the Aye Root, at any rate. Our protagonist Yuichi returns to the same town from the last four routes to literally bump into his past because miracles or something, I don't know. Succulent sunset symbolism supplements scenes in which our 10-year-old heroine overuses her kawaii moe moe trait because Hisaya had no idea what he was doing during the early parts of this route. On his way, he kicks an amnesiac out of his house to freeze to death on a hill, enables an unkawaii pig dog of a girl to ignore the existence of her dying sister, and who even knows what happens to Mai. His aunt doesn't get hit by a car, though, so Nayaki gets off. Okay.
Wait a second, was this the Aye Root?
Yeah, it's Kanon as a whole and the Aye Root.
Okay.
Alright. That was not expected, but okay.
I did not have much time to write that.
Nonetheless, thank you very much. So this is your second podcast you've been on. You were on the one of the Charlotte ones, I think it was episode 5?
At least two of them, because I brought up the salad twice.
It's good to have you back. I know you're a huge diehard fan of Kanon. It's kind of in your name, so I'm glad.
Kind of.
It's kind of like...
Only kind of.
Kind of like we need to have you on one of these podcasts. So
It's my aesthetic.
Thank you very much.
I thought your aesthetic was Haruka.
Wait till the little Buster's Book Club.
Yes.
Alrighty then.
Right, so, Aye Root guys, how did you rate it? Let's go around in a circle. Pi, how'd you rate it?
I gave it a 4. I think it's pretty iconic route, and it's definitely a major part of what makes Kanon what it is, so, yeah, gave it a 4.
Mm-hmm. Pepe, what'd you rate it?
I gave it a 2.
A 2?
Yeah. Yes, I believe it. Well, I think my biggest gripe right now is it fails to make its message clear. It fails to make its value clear to the reader, and I guess I'll be talking about that for the rest of the podcast.
Fair enough. What do you rate it, Kanon?
Well, I don't rate things on Kaza. I don't think 1 to 5 is nearly big enough. Because I don't like giving perfect ratings, I'll go for 4.5, 4.5.
Okay.
Fair enough. I was like in favor of a 10-point rating system, but I think we decided on a 5 because it gets a bit complicated after that. We tried to keep it simple. Anyway, that's a tangent for another day. I rated it a 3. Kind of like...
Down the middle.
Yeah, I don't really know how to feel about this route yet. I came out reading it a few hours ago. And I still don't know what I think of it. So hopefully this podcast will help me determine that a little bit. Either way, I could go either way on this. So yeah, let's see what happens, I guess.
It all started 7 years ago.
When Yuichi was... Well, Yuichi was...
A little swag lord, that's what he was.
Yeah, he was a swag lord. Fucking just running into girls, treating them taiyaki.
Treating them like...
That's how you get a girl, guys.
Just breaking girls' hearts left and right and then leaving the town to leave them all devastated.
Well... Well, I mean, that wasn't his choice. Didn't really have control over that, did he? Did he?
Well, let's see. He ruined... He, like, abandoned Makoto. He flat out was an asshole to Nayuki for, like, no good reason. He was just being emo.
Is that not a good reason?
Like, maybe...
I mean, it's...
But it's okay. It still doesn't feel justified.
Like, okay. She didn't get it as bad as Shiori. He didn't even talk to Shiori.
Yeah, but that's good. He didn't break her heart. She's like the only one that was spared. And Mai, of course, broke her little heart. Didn't go back.
That was her own fault.
What was the reason?
He didn't. He didn't go back even though he came back to the town. Yeah, that was a nice move. That was a
good
move.
Oh, right. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Poor Mai.
See? My 30-second recap is coming back. We're talking about every other girl but Ayu.
And Ayu was the one that he just left for dead.
He broke more than a heart.
Broke
a spine.
Wasn't Yuichi's fault. No.
It wasn't.
He just came there late.
Yeah, I mean,
even if he was early, then it wouldn't have made a difference.
It probably wouldn't have made a difference either way. I think you could attribute this to Yuichi for the fact that he introduced her to the tree.
Oh, yeah.
If they didn't meet,
fucking
that would have
happened. Asshole. Fucking asshole.
Oh, dear. So, yeah, Yuichi, poor kid. He's had quite the childhood. And, I guess the whole point of canon is that this was so messed up that it ended up being completely erased from his memory.
Along with a lot of his other memories of the town. And I think this route ties into that, into the whole setting of canon, where it says, the seven memories from 7 years ago are buried under the snow. And the reason why they're so buried is specifically because of his experience with Ayu and what happened at the end of the route.
Yeah.
Oh, that was a nice wording there. Buried under the snow. They really, his sire at least, he really goes nuts with the setting. He likes making references to the snow.
He does. And you like making references to the snow in your post, don't you, Ken?
Oh, the sunset.
And the sunset.
The one snow reference that's coming to mind right now is he describes Ayu's smile as melting. I'm like, oh, baby. But it's just so casually thrown in, and he's constantly making comparisons to snow and reference to snow and just gobbling up that beautiful setting, which is the best key setting. I'm not going to let you argue that.
I do agree with it in that it is the best key setting because it has this whole somber tone about it.
I feel like Asaya really...
What's the point in making all these references to the setting?
Natural. You know, my favorite word. it just, naturally blends the route into the setting and makes it all feel fantastic and wonderful and... What's the word? Gets you involved, sucks you in. There's a word for it. Please help.
Engages you.
Yeah, I'll take it. it engages you. It pulls you into the world.
Immersed.
Thank you, Bernkus.
Immersion. I personally think it's natural enough with them acting as real people.
My winter aesthetic.
I don't think it needs these multiple references to the setting because we already know the setting.
The school
I feel
Little
engaged
Vistas
enough about it.
It's just a school. And the town, it's a big part of Clannad. I mean, that one's better, but it's not like super in the dialogue all over the place. Aside from, I hate this town.
It's not referenced as much as canon is. It's they don't put as much symbolism into the town, but that symbolism being there, I simply don't see the point.
I think it's just expanding the everything. This is why
the question you have to ask yourself. So the question you have to ask yourself is, would it be the same story if it took place somewhere else or at a different time? And I think it would be a different story.
I think it would be a different story. What I'm saying here is, would it be the same story if they didn't make all these references, all this symbolism, all this comparison between the snow and the sunset?
Look, I think there's one thing you need to account for here, and that's tone. And what Kanon does really well is this somber tone, because winter, it's a very sort of somber sort of season. Snow, it's very somber feeling. It's got a bit of a different feeling to rain, where it can be very violent and, all that. Snow is more like, it softly falls down, it's very cold, but it's also got this sense of isolation in how, you don't usually see many people, walk out in the snow unless it's let's make it snowman, then it has the sort of fun snow, which is another thing that Shiori, I think it was, that got onto. There's, you can enjoy the fun side of snow and the sad side of snow. I'm just rambling. tone is important. And I think, winter does a really good job of, connecting winter itself to the tone of canon and the stories of the girls. And I think that's pretty cool.
I just think canon has the best... tone, atmosphere, all of that, of all key, I believe Kanon does it best, and those things are important, and just having it automatically already have it for every scene and not need to be reset and all that jargon. That is one of Canon's strongest points, I believe.
I don't think all of the routes need to be set in the winter. Like, my... I think it might just be a minor thing. My and Makoto's routes could have been set in any other season. And that would have been fine.
It's been pretty well documented that Hisaya certainly knew what he was doing with Kanon more than Maida.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think, like,
yeah, for sure.
Hisaya had a much more clear vision there. But, yeah. I feel like the whole winter thing really comes to a head in Shiori's route with the whole, like, basically dying in the snow. Like, that's powerful stuff. I don't think that would have felt quite as the same if it was just, like, a hot day.
Sun shining.
I think there are a few moments in this route where the snow is kind of really interesting, particularly with the scenes on the porch where Ayu really wants to go outside into the snow and Yuichi really doesn't want
it's
to.
Like,
and
no,
I think
it's too cold.
Yeah, I think it's interesting because it really helps to set up Yuichi as being like an outsider here. You know, he doesn't want to be out in the cold, and Ayu is just like, she's perfectly happy out there because this is her town, this is where she belongs.
And this is especially big in Nayuki's route, where it's just like Nayuki getting like Yuichi getting used to the town involves getting used to the cold, which involves, like, you know, once he accepts the cold, he's like truly become part of the town and, like, you know, basically reconnected with his childhood almost, as a way of looking at that.
Mm-hmm.
There's definitely a lot of like physical reasoning for the town being in winter, how it affects the characters, how it affects the stories of the characters. But because Kanon makes such a big deal of it, I want to hear how it affects the narrative. Like,
it's gonna get confusing when you say Kanon now because we got a person named Kanon.
Oh well, nothing I can do about that unless we give him a nickname.
Kanon-kun.
Kanon-kun.
Hello.
Okay.
I'll take it, sure.
Kanon-kun. Alright, Kanon-kun. The way... Because one thing I noticed about the Kanon-kun's post on the forum is that you do point out this whole, like, the way the narrative is very... indicates the symbolism. Like, how the... You do go on and on about how, like, the orange sun setting can be compared to the blood on that obviously starts pouring out when Ayu falls down from the tree. And while I find it very interesting, it's cool, yeah. I want to hear, like, how does that improve the story?
Okay, first of all, that's not me comparing the sunset to the blood. That's Isaiah. He did that one.
Technically, it is.
Well, affect the story. Well, it certainly gives this amazingly consistent feeling.
Yeah.
Cohesive.
Cohesive. You're a good man, Aspie. So that's just wonderful. I love that. But how does it affect the story? Maybe not. And I said in my post, this route is not written as well as Shiori, but I like it better for other reasons. For example, it's got this cohesive-ass sunset imagery. Mm. That just feels good, man. You like that the sun's out. It's matching Ayu's color scheme.
Mm.
It's consistent. Mm. It's lovely. And if you can't see that, well, but to me, it's wonderful. I love it. It's just perfect.
It seems more like a piece of art, I think. The way you describe Ayu's route, it feels like a piece of art. And I think...
Perhaps.
I think, personally, the reason why I gave it a 2 is because... This is my mindset. I'm not forcing other people to follow this mindset. Is that I do not look at stories as pieces of art. I usually analyze them as, like, I like to analyze them and try to see what they can give of value to the reader and from the characters. And so if you look at it from that perspective, then yes, it's very good. It's just that I think what we see as good is very subjective.
Certainly.
Yeah, I think, Pepe, if I can just kind of psychoanalyze you a little bit as far as your preferences go, you seem to really worship at the, you know, at the altar of plot. And really the only thing that matters to you is the plot of the story and what parts of that plot are kind of left open and whether there are interesting explanations for those parts of the plot. And so things like the quality of the writing or characterization or symbolism or any of that stuff is not going to be as important to you as the plot.
I wouldn't say it's just the plot, because the plot itself alone can provide an interesting story, but I'd like to look on what it can provide to the reader. Like, what sort of messages it can provide to the reader, and how the plot tries to show that, and how the writing tries to show that.
I want the experience. I want to experience the roots, and if you're just going to give me some sunset symbolism the whole way, I'm just going to be like, oh, baby.
I mean, like, we could talk a little bit more about that. The whole point, like, the sunset matches Ayu's palette, which is especially interesting. And every time we see Ayu, it's in the sunset at the shopping mall, usually. Like, there's that huge connection that the visual novel makes between sunset and Ayu. It's like, they're inseparable. And then it's kind of ironic, then, that we see that Ayu fell from the tree in the morning, not in the sunset. Even though, like, most of the CGs of her in the tree are at sunset, when she falls, it's not sunset, it's actually the morning. And then we think
so
back to that whole, like,
is not
that,
red.
That whole, like, red thing in, like, the dream sequences. It's like you said, Canon, it's not talking about the sunset.
No.
I really like that, so I just thought I'd have to draw attention to that here.
Yeah.
So I guess my question is, while I think it was cool and everything, What does that tell us as readers?
It tells us that the sunset looks really nice.
I mean, we can. I know that by looking out my window every day, but okay.
Yeah. You had an interesting point here, Canon. You had a point of, like, what the sunset could symbolize.
Oh, that's reaching way too far, but
it might be. But
you mean the thing where. Where Ayu's like halfway between awake and sunset's like halfway between the sun going down.
Yeah, I can.
Hang on, let me say that again more poetically. well, you know, Ayu's in her coma, right? She's not awake, but she's always dreaming. So she's like half awake. And a sunset, it's not night yet. No, it's not day either, it's halfway. So both Ayu and the sunset, they're both halfway. They're really, like, the sunset represents Ayu.
Oh.
Well, I don't know. I like, there's certain ways you can go about this. I feel like the sunset, for me, I feel like it symbolizes, especially in the context of childhood, it's a time when the fun times are about to end.
Oh, baby Aspie, please. I love you.
And, like, you know, I think that's something that's brought up a lot in this route. It's like, I wish these fun times could last forever. And it's like, I think there was even a quote, like, why is parting so sad or something? Was that in this route? Yeah, I was right. I wonder why parting is so sad. It's what Ayu says in the tree. Yay, I was right. Anyway. So, yeah, I feel like that really, like, that whole quote there was actually made in the sunset on the tree. So it's like, it really hammers in the symbolism here of the sunset representing, like, you know, it's a point where you're having fun, but the fun times are about to end. It's sort of like a fleeting.
You gotta go.
It's a fleeting, you know, happiness. Like a firework on fleeting. Hey!
In winter? We're gonna talk about some winter fireworks?
And, I mean, considering that, why is parting so hard? What do you think the route is telling us to do when we have to part? I mean, Yuichi definitely had to leave Ayu whether or not the accident happened, and that was not under his control as far as we know. So, I mean, in that case, what do you think the route tells us we should do?
Don't forget
what
your
should
cherished
we do
memories,
after
peeps.
We part?
Huh? Don't forget your cherished memories, peeps.
Yep.
You're parting, but they're still there in your mind.
Yep.
As long as you don't Yuichi.
As long as you don't Yuichi.
Which is, don't go full Yuichi.
I think I definitely see that like, because a lot of people are mentioning to not forget your memories, because Yuichi was tried to hide the bad things and not look at it. And
okay, but
I failed to see how the route wanted to tell that to us as the readers.
The gears are meshing, Pepe. The gears are meshing in my head right now. We also have the situation with Ayu's mother. And Ayu has experienced her own loss, and she's just, like, desperately trying to get over it. And so we have Yuichi here, which sort of gives her this sort of play and an ability to not get over it, but be able to smile, even though, like, the bad stuff has happened, and be able to remember her mother. But, like...
Happy times, I believe she said.
Yeah, but, that's the thing here, is that there was this really good line where it's like, I don't know what it is, but I'm glad you've gotten over it, is what Yuichi says. And she says, I haven't gotten over it. I don't think I ever will. It's like, whoa.
I think that's when her smile melted.
Yeah. And just like, doesn't that like speak so true to anybody's experience, grief? You know, we won't get over it, but that doesn't mean we can't continue smiling and remember the happy times. And I think that's probably the key message that this route is trying to get across here.
I think the reason why it couldn't get across to me is I didn't really see that Yuichi losing his memories as something that affected him that much. Like, he was living a fairly decent life at the start of the story, even with those memories suppressed. And after he regained those memories, how did that affect him? Like, how did that change Yuichi after he remembered that, yes, Ayu is probably dead? How did it change his perception? And that's what I failed to see. That's what the route failed to show me. And I'm trying to think about it. And I've tried to think about it for the past, like, 6-7 years since I read Kanon.
It's been 7 years.
Yes!
It's been 6 years. It's been, yes, well... I don't remember.
Just say 7 years.
7 years, yeah.
Alright. You definitely make a point there. And I believe, as we said pre-podcast, it was somebody... a lot of this route at the end kind of relies on the twists and the emotional value brought by them. And I'm afraid that maybe I cannot answer your question, peeps.
Okay,
it was better written than Shiori.
I don't want you to try and convince me it's good. I'm disappointed because I want to be told, because I can't see it for myself, but I guess I will never know. Actually, Naoki Satin did post on the forum about that. He did. That's where I'm getting those ideas from. But I was wondering if maybe I'll talk to him later on personally or on the forum, and I'll try to see how he thought that way. I would love to learn more about it.
What I really like is that the whole thing about Ayu's wish being to forget about me. That's like her.
You already fucked that one up.
Yeah.
Wasn't her first wish to never forget about me?
Yeah, and he fucked that up, and then she wishes to forget about me, and he fucks that up too.
And he fucked that up.
Forget about me. And he fucked that up. Yeah.
Let's make this place a school. Oh, I got cut down. He fucked that one up. You blew it, Hisaya. He should have responded with, "I could never grant that wish. I can only grant wishes that I can grant."
What was his exact line? It's, you can only make wishes that I can grant for you, something like that. And I thought that would have been perfect, because he could say, like, I will never be able to forget you, and that would be a pretty strong thing. It's pretty strong message to the reader.
Damn
it,
it's like, yeah.
I think if they put that line, I might have cried, so, but...
You might have given it a 4.
Actually... Yeah. It hinges on that, so I don't want to say it hinges on that, but maybe it does.
You're so fickle, Pepe.
Yeah, I definitely was hoping that would be the line, and it didn't come through for me, so there you go.
I mean, you could complain about that being cliche and cheesy, because everyone here thought it was going to happen, but man, Kanon is so cliche and cheesy, I love it.
That's like Shiori, like, makes a huge point of that. You know, how much, like, this is just like a TV drama.
Yeah. So what is it? It's good.
Definitely a line that should have been there.
Yeah.
I just watched the anime like a few hours earlier, but the problem is I watched it in Japanese because Ki is doing this Ki Week and they're streaming everything in Nico Nico video only in Japan. And he does say, it feels like he says a lot more in the anime at the end.
Yes, definitely.
And I didn't pick up all of that because it was in Japanese. If anyone cared to try to...
He does.
I feel like there could have been more here with the writing in terms of like justifying, you know, forgetting and then remembering and then the importance of all that. But it kind of just like becomes irrelevant because she survives anyway. But then I'm thinking in a new direction and you could interpret, well, it's actually probably true that if Yuichi didn't remember everything that happened with Ayu, Ayu would just leave, like her spirit would leave and never come back and never be revived, I'd say. And I'd say it's like him choosing to remember Ayu and like spend time with her and like wish for that miracle is what caused Ayu to be revived in the first place. So,
On that note, the miracle, huh?
The miracle.
Oh yes, the miracle.
We should
definitely had a miracle happen somewhere.
Yeah.
If
you didn't put two and two together, I think it's become apparent by this point that the miracle that's referenced in all the other routes, there's a different miracle in each route. That would have to be the final wish of Ayu from the doll.
Yeah.
And that's,
I think those were only referenced in Nayuki's and Shiori's route, by the way. I tried to look for them in Makoto's and Mai's route and they weren't referenced.
Makoto's had it. She fucking came back to
life.
Was
it? I mean, was that the miracle? What is it? Okay, anyway, whatever.
The miracle or the fox magic is what you're trying to say, is it, peeps?
Okay.
Yeah, Makoto is like, that happens no matter what route. So that's not the miracle. That is fox magic.
No, I think Ashby is talking about her coming back to life in like the very last CG.
I think that's the miracle.
I really don't want to believe that she came back to life. That's such a cheesy ending.
That's a whole different route, I think.
Yeah, that's the thing. That's just inconsistencies. Inconsistencies, blah, between Maida
and Maida's a hack.
Maida's a hack. But yes. I feel like Maida was just told by Hisaya, put a miracle at the end. It's like, oh, okay. just to keep.
And then he decided to give that up in my route and say, fuck miracles.
Right. Maida
had a miracle.
Yeah,
which one?
The part where she lived the stabbing herself in the chest part.
Oh.
I think the miracle is
did
the same.
Did she live? I mean, did she live?
I think this makes it very clear that the answer is yes.
Yes.
I'm still not fully convinced that she lived.
I prefer the interpretation that was Hope-chan that saved her, but that's kind of what
you can use whatever interpretation you want, but I think at this point, as far as the narrative goes, it's pretty clear that what they want you to believe is that it's this miracle from Ayu's doll. So
in the anime, it was Hope-chan, and that's what I said in the podcast, so I'm like, yeah.
What's this anime shit? Come on.
I know, we can't really use the anime as a good source here.
I don't think we'll get anywhere go back to my.
Can I just tell you guys what I think the miracle is already?
Yeah, go ahead. Go.
I think it's the same in every single route. I think it's, I wish Yuichi-kun was happy. And if he's gonna be happy, everyone who isn't Makoto has to live.
Oh my god. I need 5 seconds to get over what you just said. Okay. That's actually a very valid interpretation. And like ever since this is my second time reading canon, and like from the point that I started, I was kind of trying to connect everything to Ayu's route in that way. So I guess that is very valid. Like, this doll that Yuichi says grants wishes somehow was made into an actual doll, an actual wish-granting device that Ayu can control. And she wishes Yuichi to be happy. Maybe because she can see, despite being in a coma, what is happening to Yuichi in that town. Maybe not, I don't know.
She's dreaming, peeps.
Oh, she's streaming. Oh.
She's not streaming, she's dreaming.
I'm deaf, I'm sorry.
I believe the coma Ayu can see what's going on through her dreams, because canon is just magic.
About the dream, what do you guys think that Ayu is dreaming about while she's in that coma? Because I thought what the story was kind of saying, like, she has this dream that goes over and over again of her waiting in the bench.
That's
a thing that happens, yeah.
Yeah, that's one of them, but she dreams of other things. She dreams of the red snow part.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure she dreams of the town as well at other points.
She dreams about, Shiori and Kaori at one point.
Oh, yeah, she does, doesn't she?
And there's actually one of these dream sequences which actually wasn't Ayu, which, like, really, like, messes with me. I think it was...
Which one?
I believe it was Maya's Root, and it's, like, the Hope Spirit is talking in one of those dream segments. It's just like, no, you can't go pulling that shit on us. Yeah, because she says, Maida. Like, I'm Hope. You can call me Hope. That was a dream sequence, wasn't it? Can anyone confirm that?
It probably doesn't have Yakusoku playing during it.
Yeah,
so it probably doesn't count.
Oh, so you need the Yakusoku playing for it to count.
I
don't know if it was that one, but there was definitely another one that clearly wasn't Ayu, and it's just like inconsistencies, blah. But whatever, that's probably a Maeda problem. Let's just focus on Hisaya's roots, eh?
All right, I'm fine with that.
Yeah, the one author here who's not a hack.
Until 2014
or whatever it came out.
Rip Maeda. Why don't we talk about... Okay, there's two directions we could talk about here. We could talk about that ending, or... I don't know if there's a lot we can talk about there, but... I'm going to talk about...
I had some more stuff to ask about dreams.
All right.
About Ayu's dreams.
Go on then,
so,
Pepe.
Well,
we have lots of time.
Okay. So, like... I guess...
Maid is crying from the hospital. He's dreaming about this. Oh, no.
Oh, my God. How could you guys?
You're a hack.
So, I guess basically Ayu's dreams, like, she can see what's happening around the town. Is that in any way connected to her spirit, do you guys think? Like, her astral projection?
Astral projection!
Does what she see... Is what she sees connect only limited by what her astral projection can see? Or is she seeing a lot more?
So you think there's a ghost, like running around the city, basically?
There is.
There's a ghost running around the city, stealing taiyaki, bumping into brown-haired guys, pretty much.
Do you want to make a distinction here between ghost Ayu and dream Ayu? Because that leads us to be interesting.
That's what I'm trying to do. Yes, like, well, I can't give an answer. This is just a thought. What do you call that?
I think the astral projection is just born of Ayu's magic and dreams on her spider sense going off that Yuichi is back in the town. Same thing as Makoto. She senses he's back in the town. And
yeah, that's true.
Turned into a person, debatably. Yeah.
It's born from fighting spirit.
Yeah, it's just born from love and dreams and hopes and fucking magic. It's canon.
Candy falling from the sky.
It's definitely...
Power of love, man.
Definitely a bit broken because it doesn't remember exactly what happened to Ayu.
Ayu doesn't remember what happened to Ayu.
But I think it is Ayu.
Mm-hmm.
It's just magic.
It's just a little bit broken.
And I think that is completely fine. Because it's magical.
Right.
It's love, man.
Yeah,
love,
bro.
Love transcends time and space, yo.
Oh my god, Kid Ayu and Kid Yuichi is the cutest. Oh, it's
actually
so cute.
Yes, yes, they are very cute.
Just be thankful there was no time travel.
Ayu, Ayu! I guess this is just a me thing. When you tell me it's magic, I try to figure out how does this magic work.
You're not gonna get any answers in canon. Not really.
Yeah. All right. I'll stop.
Maybe in other key series you'll have better luck, but not canon.
I can understand not liking this route because of that. I can totally understand it. But for me, it's
how does love work?
Yeah. I'm. Hey! I'm not saying that this is a flaw. I'm not saying that it should make sense. I'm just saying that I like to do this because it's fun.
Yeah.
I'm not.
Anyway, let's like. As much as I love to hear you stumbling over this, we should move on.
Because Biz thinks I'm shitting on the route for this magic. I'm not.
I don't think he is.
God damn it, Biz!
Anyway, so there's kind of an elephant in the room. That's like an interesting post on the forum that I really want to draw attention to.
Let's go.
Forum member Takafumi brings up an interesting theory surrounding Ayu's existence, where he believes that Ayu was created by Yuichi and not by the Ayu in the coma. Now, the evidence we have for this is the hairband and the whole thing about how that scene never happened and Ayu was never shown that headband, and yet she is wearing it in like her dream apparition. Love ghost is wearing the headband. And that
she's not just wearing it. She knows it's a gift from someone precious to her.
Oh.
Yeah, and that's something she could never have known. Sure, it's magic, but like you said, Pepe, it's fun to think about this kind of thing, and maybe that does have a purpose to it. Two conclusions we can draw from this. One, Yuichi is fucking insane and Ayu never existed and everyone else is just going along with his delusion. Or two, it's some sort of weird magic sort of thing where Yuichi has summoned a ghost from his past and is sort of like, it's like the ghost of Christmas past here to tell Yuichi that don't forget about me.
The way I understood Taka's post is neither of those two options. It's more like there is a higher power. There is like this magical being, which is not Ayu, but Yuichi gives a shape to that being. That's how I understood Taka's interpretation.
He puts a coat on a light orb and follows it around.
Exactly.
And that
gives it some taiyaki.
Yeah, that's very interesting to think that this this isn't actually a representation of Ayu, but something that he created.
Right.
I think it's an interesting theory. I mean, more than anything else, it is just kind of supported by the fact that what he knows about Ayu is about all we see. We don't really learn a whole lot of new information about Ayu through through his story. We mostly learn new information about her through his memories of her. Mm-hmm. And even like the part where, you know, she gets injured, he doesn't ever find that out from her until after he's seen it himself and has remembered it himself.
There's lots of weird stuff going on. Like, I really found it interesting how like Ayu is like conscious and like fully like she seems like a physical person, and then like she goes to school every day and doesn't realize that school doesn't exist. It's like a computer game where the NPC like goes off the map and then comes back just like out of sight.
She goes to school every day, she doesn't know it exists, and before she started living at the Munisei residence, the fuck did she do at night?
Yeah,
I really think that like once she gets far enough away from Yuichi, she basically like fades out of existence.
Yeah, it's sort of like if you don't look at her, she doesn't exist, like a fucking quantum sort of shit.
if an Ayu says Ugu and no one is there to hear it, is she really there?
Thought experiments, canon 101.
If a tree falls in the forest and there's no Ayu in it, did she die?
You're killing me. My mic's peaking, god damn it.
For real though. I think that is a super, super interesting theory. But that's not romantic. That's not canon at all. And that's why I cannot subscribe to it, even though it makes sense and it's really interesting and I do like it. But I can't, because that's not canon.
It's just love, dude. You don't gotta explain shit.
But I can definitely appreciate that theory. But that is the most I can give it.
Yeah, there's just weird stuff going on in this route. It's just like, I don't know, it's like why I can't get a good grip on it, because there's just lots of weird stuff happening. And, you know, obviously we've talked about how the symbolism and in terms of like presentation art, it's really fucking skillful. But I'm also on the side of Pepe here where it's like, the plot didn't do much for me. It's just kind of a bunch of things happen. Like, I didn't feel like there was no climax and no resolution. It just things happen.
That's not my side.
Aspie, there is a climax. If you don't know she's in a coma, there's a climax where she dies and disappears.
But sorry, it's very brief, and then she's back.
I personally had no problems with the plot, actually. Like, I thought the plot was pretty clear in where it was going and what it was going to... I thought it was the messages that weren't clear.
On the topic of the plot being clear, the foreshadowing in this route is... You know what has long shadows? People during the sunset.
Yeah, yeah.
There is so much foreshadowing in this route, and it's good foreshadowing. It's vague, but it's obvious. Mm.
Okay, about
if
the
you don't pick up on it, you won't pick up on it. But if you pick up on it, everything is spelled out and nothing's an ass pull. What I believe.
About the foreshadowing.
And I think that's good writing.
All right. I think I did make a point about that. Because as we talked about, if you already know the whole mystery, then you will notice all of that foreshadowing. But if you don't, you may or may not notice it. But the key here is that Yuichi himself does not notice it.
Well, that's because he doesn't see the dream sequences.
Well, true, but there's a lot of fishy things going on with Ayu. It's like her school is school being an unbelievable
Taiyaki is shaped
school.
Like fish. You said fishy things.
Oh my, what the fuck? Alright, okay.
Canon.
That's symbolism right there.
Canon, please.
I can be the next Isaiah.
There was like a lot of stuff about that sort of indicated that Ayu is from the past, because like she wasn't familiar with modern technology at all. It's just.
Interesting. Brought a couple of those up.
Yeah. I think there's a disconnect between the reader and Yuichi in this case. Because...
And she's a fucking child, let's not forget that.
So I think there's a disconnect between Yuichi and the reader in this case, because if, say, you're reading it for the first time, you'd probably feel a bit suspicious, like, what's up with this Ayu kid?
Yuichi's a bit of an idiot, I guess.
Yuichi does not once doubt it, and I think that's a bit of a disconnect, because in Makoto's route, he doubts everything about Makoto, but anyway.
Yeah,
again, inconsistency.
He already is familiar with Ayu. Like, they catch on to that really quickly. It's like, oh yeah, you're that Ayu. And then, why would he question that she exists? He already knows her. Like, yeah, I don't think it seems all that unusual.
Is it really in Yuichi's personality to not doubt her being in a school, in a crazy school like that?
It is, because he doesn't doubt demons.
Now whatever hold I had on Yuichi's personality is slowly losing its grip. What is Yuichi really?
A dick.
Is his personality?
A dick.
Yeah, I know he's a dick. He's obviously a dick.
So, do you know what we haven't talked about?
What haven't we talked about?
Ayu. We haven't talked about Ayu at all. We talked about the room.
No, we have not.
Talked about canon things. We've completely ignored the heroine. I like Ayu.
I guess she's okay.
Like younger Ayu a lot.
Yeah, little Ayu is cute.
I don't like the start of the root Ayu. That's an Ogu bot.
You were saying that
little Ayu acts her age.
After she moves in and mellows out, she becomes a much better character and closer to her younger self. She's cheerful, but she's got this fucking melancholic feel to her at all times because dead mom and all that.
Yeah.
Maybe it happens after Yuichi remembers that it's the same IU.
I'm gonna stop.
I'm gonna be critical here, and like, I won't say she's a bad character, but there's nothing about IU that really attracts me. Most of her appeal comes from very surface aspects, like Ugu and the Taiyaki thing and the glomping, and it's all very surface level stuff. She doesn't really feel like a person to me. She just feels like a mass of drama and character quirks. And I'm going to go back to Shiori here and talk about a character that actually feels like a real person. And I was like immensely like attracted to her and invested in her, basically. But I was just kind of like, she just, everything about her is very surface level, and just I don't know what Ayu's really like. I don't know what she really cares about, her dreams or aspirations or anything like that. I have no idea, and I think you make the point
like
of not knowing either.
You're focusing too much on Ayu at the start, and not
am
when
I?
She chills out. Yeah, she completely changes in the later route. She stops being an Ogu bot. She's not screaming about Taiyaki.
Yes, she is.
I do agree with Kanon on this. I think, like, after the first few days, she starts to mellow out. You can see that she's not an idiot, which like, some of the routes may have, like, some of the first parts of the story may have seemed to imply. She has a pretty straight head on her, I think. And it's just Yuichi keeps bullying her that makes her like,
get riled up.
Always, yeah, get riled up.
But do we really know anything about who she is as a person?
I mean, since she is a 10-year-old who has been stuck in a coma for the past 7 years.
Okay. That's a pretty good comeback.
It's hard to, you know, talk to a 10-year-old and figure out what their dreams and aspirations are.
That's a good
what
point.
They are as a person.
Not just a 10-year-old, she's also a 10-year-old who's been broken by dead mom.
Yeah. Okay, you got me.
Again, that does go into the whole consistency thing.
But she's been able to come out of it cheerful, thanks to Yuichi.
Yay.
And while she doesn't lift as much as Shiori, she might go to the gym every now and then.
Hi, what do you think of Ayu?
I like Ayu's character, I mean, honestly, it might just be that I actually enjoy the little quirks that she has. So the fact that she is just kind of a collection of quirks doesn't really bother me. But at the same time, I think that she's a fairly interesting character in the sense that she's unapologetically cute. Like, they don't really...
Unapologetically.
Yeah, I mean, she's got, like, her little quirks with the... like Ugu and also like the Boku and all of these other things that make her who she is, and they don't really try too hard to push her beyond that, and you know, she doesn't really seem like a dramatic character. She's just kind of almost like a comedy character who's given a dramatic role.
That does seem to describe her pretty well. Like, she is naturally cute. They don't try to push the cuteness on her, which I can't say the same for a lot of the moe characters in the future. If you like her, you like her. If you don't, you don't.
Let's talk about Yuichi.
Oh, my hero.
Yuichi.
My main man. Obviously, we've talked about how much he's a dick, but I don't think that's all there is to him. I kind of like his sarcastic edge and just general... snarkiness. I definitely feel like I could put myself in his shoes because just, you know, lots of like weird things happening around him, and he is quick to question them. He's just like, whenever someone's acting weird, he won't like avoid giving them shit for that. Unless it's Mai. He kind of like really soft around Mai because he's desperate to make her actually say anything because she just doesn't react to any retorts he could possibly give.
Yuichi is weird. All the girls call him weird. They're all weirdos. Everyone in Canon's a weirdo. It's one of its strong points.
Yeah.
Right. He's a huge dick. massive dick, but he's too much of a big softy good guy. And no matter how much he tries to be a dick, all the girls can see he's a big softy.
Somehow that's that sounds true. Yeah.
He tries to be manly, but no, he's a loser.
Oh, he's wow.
He's a romantic loser. Yeah. And all the girls can see that. But he wants to be manly and gruff and a dick. So also, he's a bully. I think he just enjoys being a bully. He likes to have fun.
Yeah.
But he's not a bully to all of the characters. That's one thing I've noticed out of all of Kanon. He seems to... Someone said this, I don't remember who, but he seems to change his, like, the way he acts depending on who he's talking to.
Absolutely.
If it's a character who he believes is acting immature, then he will be quick to bully them.
He will be quick to act even more immature. But with, like, Sayuri or Akiko, he's polite and respectful. Mostly, and with Mai, he makes fart jokes.
Fart joke.
I feel like Yuichi is the most consistent key protagonist across all the routes. Because he is multi-faced, so any changes can be brought up to. He acts different with different people.
Yeah, no, I can actually agree with that statement. There's also Yukito, but
Yukito is more consistent.
Small of a sample size, like there's only three girls there, so it's not really like he can change that much.
Maybe.
But yeah, Yuichi is extremely consistent, more so than Tomoya, more so than Kintaro, more so than Riki. Yeah.
Much more than Riki.
Yeah, I can get behind that statement a lot.
What about Otonashi?
What about Otonashi?
No one's read First Beat Pepe. And yes, more than Otonashi.
I think it's interesting, because Yuichi comes from a time where... era gay protagonist was expected to be a pair of eyes and a dick. But he comes across as this consistent character, and he comes across as this character, which is important.
He's a character, yeah. Like, that's a thing, like, I still see today in video game critiques. It's like, oh, I want my character to be a blank space so I can self-insert and have my immersion and be the hero. And I'm like, no, like, what's wrong with playing a game where a character is actually their own character? Like, I find that much more interesting from an experience perspective. You know, I want to be someone different when I'm playing a video game. You know, I want to have these different experiences.
The chemistry between Yuichi and the girls is a big, important part of Kanon, and if that was not there, it wouldn't be very good. Yuichi is really important.
Have you guys ever actually played the game where the character is a pair of eyes and a dick?
Yes.
Yeah.
Alright. I don't think I have, but okay.
Because I don't
all the
it.
VNs... all the VNs I've tried, even the ones that focus on the R18 aspect, do not treat the main character that way. But I guess I shouldn't play games that are like that anyway.
Well, you know I go to extremes.
Yeah.
They wouldn't quite be that, but Yuichi was probably several orders of depth. Had several orders of depth more than his his co-protagonist at the time.
Yeah, no, I agree.
Because, well, like, at the time, I remember White Album was also released. I think White Album was released even before Key. And that protagonist is very much not a self-insert, but anyway.
I don't think Kanon is revolutionary in any aspect, and I think that's why it's probably one of the worst-selling key visual novels, my understanding is. But it doesn't mean it's bad. It's still got lots of polish there, and it's definitely, I'd say, probably one of the best of the time.
Oh, it's so polished. Especially...
I can't say the same for the English patch.
Let's not.
Rest in peace, the great Shiori disaster of February 2009.
Kanon's visuals and atmosphere... well, visuals, let's ignore the people. The backgrounds look incredible. Especially the lighting. Kanon
and the music's good,
really
too.
Good. And the music.
Hey, and the music.
Not the biggest fan of the music on its own, but my god, does it fit.
Actually, I was pretty interested in talking a little bit about Ayu's theme, which, if I remember correctly, Pepe said at first he thought it was just like the theme for the
shopping center.
Yeah, for the shopping center.
Or the shopping street.
It's Hidemaru no Machi, was it?
Yeah. If you don't remember it, it's the one that goes like ba da 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 da. So that's supposed to be Ayu's theme. And I think it's a pretty good theme. It's got like the, you know, little piano riff in it. It's got some vibraphone, and I don't know. It's very cheerful and perky. It feels very Ayu to me. I think it definitely works well for her character. And
this game has a really good thing going on for character themes.
Yeah, I think the other thing I like about it is that the vibraphones have kind of like this sort of ringing bell thing, which is it shows up in a lot of the different Kanon songs, and there was another song that shows up at the end of basically every route. It's called Little Fragments, and that's
the
one
that plays at the epilogue where the key logo comes on. Little thing at the end card, yeah.
And I sort of see that as, at least to me, I don't know why I say this, but it feels very Ayu to me as well. I think part of it is because it has that sort of music box appeal to it, and it feels very childish. And so I kind of associate it with Ayu's character, who's sort of constantly stuck in this, you know, perpetual childhood.
Yes, I felt that too. I felt like that was reminding me of the karma that Ayu was in. And just waiting to wake up, which is weird that it played after Ayu's route, but it worked better for the other routes. Yeah.
Music boxy things scream nostalgia.
Yeah, this whole game screams nostalgia, honestly, especially because it's old now. That also helps.
It is old.
It's like a time capsule, like, hey, what Ayu did, hey.
I feel like it's aged well, because it hasn't aged well.
Huh? Oh,
I feel like being completely old and in the past just suits Kanon.
It works to its advantage, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the fact that it, you look at it and you're like, oh my god, this is so old. But it fits, it works. Somebody in the thread said HD remake when, and I was like, no, I don't want that. I want Kanon to stay 7 years ago.
Even with, would you not take a bigger window?
No.
Oh, in the memorial edition, you can increase the window size.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, standard man. Edition is shit.
Oh man. Anyway, and I also wanted to talk about Fuyu no Hanabi. Is that what it's called?
You bet
Winter
it is.
Fireworks.
Yep.
Fuyu no Hanabi. Yes. Okay. Yeah, that's a good song. It plays. It features most for Makoto and Ayu, and it kind of has a dual symbolism there of like a transient miracle, as Amano puts it. You know, a firework is just bang, it's just a big bright spark and then it's gone. But it's like fantastic for that brief moment it's there. And I feel like this works really well for, it usually plays during the,
when was 7 years ago.
Yeah, I was going to say that, I was double checking in my head. Yes. It usually plays in the scenes where it's 7 years ago with Ayu, and yeah, that's pretty much where it consistently plays. And yeah, I guess it's kind of like referencing the fact that this is a happiness which has long since passed, and it maybe this works better for Makoto, actually. I don't know. Pai, do you have any input here?
I think I talked about this song on the Makoto podcast, so if you're interested in my thoughts, you can just go back to that one.
All right.
I don't honestly remember how it's used in Makoto, because Maida is a hack.
The ending.
But in Ayu, in Ayu, it's exclusively in the past, and almost exclusively the only music used in the past. And hey, look, consistency. I was joking off about sunsets causing consistency earlier, so is all I can say about that in Aya's route.
Yeah. I like how that we should get more sound effects for Kanon.
Yeah, slapping noises is his like trademark.
Kanon or Kanon Kun?
Kanon Kun, yes.
Alright. On the topic of sound effects in Kanon, I'm late!
Ding dong!
Every time. Yeah. I had to turn down the sound effects because they were way too loud by default. It's just like,
absolutely.
Yeah, it's like, it definitely shows its age in areas like the sound direction and design. Yeah,
but
like,
it's charming.
It is charming.
Yeah,
Kanon is so charming.
I'll give it that.
We could talk a little bit about Last Regrets.
Maybe we should. Or Cassette. No, so the.
Yeah. Funky Sister Girl.
Funky Sister Girl.
That's another good song to talk about.
Yes.
So what are your thoughts on that one, the ending theme?
Pepe, say it.
O Tadoritsuku Basho.
Tadoritsuku Basho. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. The endings are happy, and we got a happy ending theme. I like
it. Yeah. The full version has rap in it. Yay.
Well, you know.
Like a walking day.
The first draft of the script had Shiori as a gangster rapper. So that's where that came from.
Oh, okay.
It's not even like an original rap. That part of the song just really infuriates me. It's a canned rap clip that you find in a fair number of Japanese songs. It's just like,
Ivesound specifically, because both tracks were arranged by Ivesound, and they like to use that rap sample in a lot of places.
It just takes me out of that song every single time.
But I gotta say, that song, Kaze no Tadoritsuku Basho, is like, you were talking about nostalgia, and I think this song has a lot of nostalgia to it. Like, with the synths used and the sound used and the way it's composed, I think it's very reminiscent of the 90s.
I'm never gonna forget the anime and how this used it, though. It's just like, this tragic scene. That music plays at the end of episode.
Torture's worse.
Yeah.
It's
like, oh, yeah, what? Akigo got run over?
But,
actually, I just remember this song when, because before they actually came out with the anime, the 2006 anime.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, no, but I mean, like, before they came out with it, they came out with this as almost like a trailer, like the ending theme. They just sort of, like, played it. And that was, I just remember watching that and being super hyped for the series, because I don't know why, it's just something about like that running through the snow and the that music playing just really put me in the mood for watching Kanon.
It's a very happy and catchy song.
Pai, he was interested in Key before any of us even heard of Key.
Oh god, I just realized something. That's the ending theme, and the melancholic mood is over, because winter's over, it's spring, we can be happy!
Yeah.
Symbolism!
Still winter in the anime,
whatever. Get your anime out of here!
I'm sorry.
I was gonna compare the ending to the opening, Last Regrets, because I did say how the ending has a lot of nostalgia to it, but I do not feel the same way for Last Regrets.
No.
I think Last Regrets ages better.
Regrets ages really well. That's a good
song.
Yeah,
like, I personally did not like Last Regrets before, but now that I'm rereading Kanon, I like it a lot more.
Yeah.
And I think it's something that could have been composed in the 50s. It's something that could have been composed yesterday, and arranged yesterday. I think it has that eternal feel to it.
Yeah. It really does. I love that song. You know, I was participating in the Kazumatsuri chorus to sing that song. I'm just belting that shit out. It's great. I love that kind of song. You know, it's got such a, you know, really reinforces that somber feeling of winter, and it's just a good
song.
Like
winter's just begun?
I guess.
The opening, after all.
Winter is coming.
This isn't Game of Thrones.
Game of Thrones reference. Hi, talk about Last Regrets.
I like Last Regrets. I think it's really hard to say anything about it other than it's just a very lyrical song. It's very, you know, smooth and flowing. It's got a somber tone. I think it's more of a poem set to music than anything else. I think that it's one of those sorts of songs that feels like it's about the words. And
we haven't
not
talked
so
about the lyrics
about the
at all, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, the lyrics really do kind of reflect what Kanon is all about. It's, you know, the lyrics are basically about smiling till the end and, you know, waking up and, you know, not being willing to say goodbye and all of these sorts of things. I think very representative of Ayu's character and just kind of the sense of going back.
I thought you just
back.
Quoted Shiori there.
Yeah.
Smiling to the end. Just go on, live, go over, and don't leave any last regrets.
Okay.
I mean, the words last regrets are not in the lyrics at all. So it's
not even in Japanese, yeah.
It's not a title that has no meaning to the song.
No, definitely.
Yeah.
I guess to finish this question, like, what did you all think of Kanon as a whole?
Yeah, what does Kanon mean
like,
to you?
I'm sure, I'm well, not what does Kanon mean to you yet, aww, but what do you think of Kanon? Because I'm sure all of us have had experiences with Kanon before, and now that we're doing this book club, what do you think of Kanon now that you've read it again and are talking about it with everyone?
What do you think,
Kai? Can I go?
Well, that's a tough one because I feel like this is the first time that I've really gone through and read Kanon. So, I mean, I tried to read it in the past and I never got all the way through it, and I've watched the anime before. So, I think that Kanon is, it's a good story. I enjoy it. It definitely feels nostalgic. I think that it's nice and tight and compact. It's not a very long story. I definitely think that it does a good job of picking a small number of themes and really sticking to those, and having, you know, it has a setting that's important to the story that you couldn't take it out of that setting and put it somewhere else. It's got music that fits really well with the mood and fits really well with all the different characters. So I like that. I think that the music kind of doesn't age well in the sense that it sounds really it sounds synthy? Much more MIDI. Sounds really, really synthy MIDI. Now. So
I still think they're good compositions, but
yeah, it's good compositions. I actually think it would be much improved if you just set a better set of instruments on top of it. Like the instrument set that they used was just really bad.
I guess comparing it to Air, which had much more intricate instruments, even though they were only 2 years, 1 year, 2 years apart? 2 years apart.
Yeah, I think you could honestly do just... I think it would be much better if you just took the same compositions, the same MIDI tracks, and you just ripped out the instruments that are built into it and stuck in something a little more modern.
Not necessarily modern, but a little more real. But, hey... I like those MIDI tracks. Those MIDI tracks are what make Kanon nostalgic.
Yeah, that's another thing. It's just the nostalgia effect where it doesn't matter if it's bad, it just adds to the feel.
Like if you replace those synths with like an actual instrument, they don't feel nostalgic anymore.
Still. With those like arrangement albums that came out shortly after, they prove you can do some really good music with Kanon OST.
You can. Yeah.
Yeah. Pepe, what do you think of Kanon?
So what I think of Kanon, I think it's a lot this is my third time experiencing Kanon, once in the anime, another time when I read it a few years back, and then now. And I think despite reading it again, despite being able to discuss it with all of you, I feel the same way as when I've read it a while back. I can't say the same for other keyworks, because I've reread Planetarian, I've reread Clannad, and I felt very different every time I've reread those. Whereas Kanon, I think I'm... I don't know what word I can use, but... I think because it doesn't rely on the emotional state of the reader too much. To show, like, yeah, I'm at a loss for words now.
here's a thought. Maybe part of that is because it really builds on the sense of nostalgia. So, you know, nostalgia is a feeling that as you, you know, move forward in time and you look back on it, you'll have the same feeling of nostalgia. Whereas other stories that aren't really built on that sense of nostalgia, when you come back to them, now you're going to see them through a lens of nostalgia that's going to change the context of it.
True.
It's kind of like a meta sort of nostalgia going on. But, how do I feel about Kanon? I don't know. I feel like it's a good visual novel. Maybe not a great one. I do feel like, of all of Key's visual novels, it's probably one of the weakest. But that doesn't mean I didn't enjoy it. I thoroughly enjoyed reading through Makoto and Mai and Shiori's roots, even a little bit. I loved Shiori, I gotta say. Like, I'm glad, because this is my first time reading the visual novel. I've seen the anime before a couple of times, but it's my first time experiencing the visual novel, and I'm glad to see, like, these roots kind of brought to life in a new way through the visual novel. Shiori's root, like, especially had lots of interesting stuff going on towards the end there that made me, like, kind of excited my intellectual theory craft aside. Makoto, I ended up appreciating a lot more than I did in the anime. Like, I used to dismiss that route, but reading it again, I'm just like, wow, this is actually pretty good. But then I read Shiori and I'm like, this might be my favorite key route ever. It was just really good. I guess, like, it's definitely lower tier compared to other key stuff. Like, nostalgia aside, I feel like it doesn't have as much wow effect as the other visual novels do. Like, Air was, like, crazy for its time. Clannad and Little Busters were equally, like, ambitious. Kanon's kind of a safe one, and I feel like that shows in some aspects, but that doesn't mean it's bad. It's definitely got a lot of strong points, especially with, like, what brought up its consistency with its theming and its symbolism and its tone. It's got some really good stuff going on there, and I definitely did enjoy reading it.
I think that's what I was trying to say. It's a very safe...
I have a question for you, Aspie. So, considering it in the context of its time that this was really the first visual novel from Key, how do you feel, you know, what do you feel like looking at some of the later works, how they sort of reflect this? You know, do you think that Kanon shows any signs of what was to come from Key, or do you think that it's...
Well, it's very important when answering that question to consider that Kanon may be Key's first work officially, but it's not the first work that they worked on together. That would be...
One.
Dose? It kind of gets mixed up. Like, there was Tactics, and they had Dose and One and Moon. I guess One is kind of like the prototypical one that everyone draws attention to, which many...
Yeah.
I haven't read it yet, but I've heard from many, many people that it is pretty much Kanon 0.5. Kanon-kun, can you confirm that?
What, Dose? One?
No, One.
It's similar.
I've heard it's quite similar to Kanon. So if you want me to answer how, like, Kanon influenced Key's later works, you're better off looking at One for that kind of question.
Well, actually, I guess what I was more saying was, like, where do you think that Key has improved since then, and where do you think that they could look at Kanon as kind of a template for things that they should go back to?
Well, for one thing, Naoki Hisaya doesn't work for Key anymore. That was his only VN for Key. Which is a little bit sad, because he's pretty solid. He's proven he can write a good story. And then we have Soren and Method.
Write a bad story.
Soren and Method happened recently.
My Sola.
Anyway, we do have Maida here, who wrote two routes, which were, I guess, quite a bit divisive on the forum. Some people didn't like those. But then he ends up writing Air, which I know Kanon has his misgivings about, but I fucking love Air. I think that's like really shows how taking like... I like really like this theme that Key has of creating a supernatural setting that's grounded in the mundane. Like, sure, Kanon's a bit crazy sometimes, but with enough like elaboration and like, you can still really feel like a story is grounded in reality and still have supernatural elements to it, which is something like I really appreciate when I read a Key story. And I feel like that's something which is mastered a lot better in stories like Air and Clannad and Little Busters. So that's one thing, but also just in terms of maybe like Maida still has a few ass pulls, but he's learned how to write you know, less confusing stories than Maestro.
True.
I don't know, there's a lot you could go into this about Pi. I know I don't want to take a whole podcast to talk about it, but I know that I can definitely feel like Maida has improved a lot since his days writing Kanon. Especially, like, I feel like he shines his most when he has a clear vision for a story and is able to execute that. Because After Story, Air, Refrain, those really, like, where they really start to focus on the core of the visual novel, those central stories, they're really fucking good. Every one of them is, like, a masterpiece, so... That's what Maida does best, in my opinion. I think it's not so much the character roots, but it's more the worldly, like, the whole story, the whole package. So when he has control over that, he can create some really amazing stuff. I don't know, does that, like, is that a satisfactory answer?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I rambled a bit, so sorry about that. And I have taken way too long going on about that. Kanon, I want to hear what you think about Kanon.
What does Kanon-kun think about Kanon?
You kind of said everything I wanted to say. I was going to talk about how the consistency is one of Kanon's stronger points over its... predecessor is the wrong word. It's the opposite.
Successors!
Yeah, so I feel it's a lot more consistent than those. Obviously, Kanon has a mild, huge personal value to myself. But objectively... It's not amazing, but it's good. It's consistent.
Pretty fucking good.
Atmosphere, characters, chemistry between the characters, that is all rock solid.
Mm-hmm.
And it has its flaws. It's not amazing. But, my God, those things it does. It does.
But
and
like,
I love it for that.
I really do like notice you have this a personal attachment to this series. Could you elaborate on that a little bit more, maybe?
We don't have that long, do we? Kanon did a thing to me. I changed a lot after Kanon. It was the first thing that really impacted me. Let's say that.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously I have an attachment to the thing that changed who I am and changed me from a pile of trash teen to a dick like Yuichi.
yeah I guess I have Kanon to thank for making you a dick.
Like, it's really hard to explain this. It's just Kanon was the whole emotional investment thing that I hadn't done for anything. Kanon forced me to do that, painfully.
I'm actually very curious how you first encountered Kanon now.
Whim.
Whim? You just saw like the 2006 anime?
Complete whim. Some guy was like, "Hey, yo, Kanon was pretty good," and I was like, "Well, I got nothing better to do." and then that drastically shifted who I am as a person, I truly believe. And as such, I have immense respect for it. And I say I love the whole symbolism, the sunset stuff, and frankly, I probably love all that stuff because Kanon did it. Kanon, like, seriously has huge impact on me. That's entirely personal. I know it's got its flaws. It's got superior successes. Little Busters and Clannad are better, much better. But Kanon is my jam. It's not my Akiko jam, but it's my Ichigo jamu. It's just my thing, and there's no way I can really convey that to anyone else, because it's what it did to me, not what it did.
No, man, that's exactly what I wanted to hear.
It's special to me, and that's all there is to it.
I think that's the point of any key story. I think Maida said that. If the story can make at least one person feel that way, then it succeeded. I think Kanon succeeded because it made you feel that way. I'm sure it made a whole lot of other people around the world feel that
Maida
way.
Maida didn't succeed. Hisaya did.
Well, yeah. Maybe Hisaya said that too. He just hasn't been on enough interviews to say that.
For the record. I liked Mai better than everything but Ayu when I first encountered it. She's gone down. Ayu has always been... Ayu's always been at the top. Shiori's gone up. Mai's gone down. Makoto has always been at the bottom. That's never changed.
Didn't you say you liked him more this read-through?
Yes, but that doesn't mean she's not at the bottom.
Okay. Yeah. Well, that's awesome. Like, that's really what I wanted to get across here. Like, I don't have the personal connection to Kanon that you do, and I can't really do anything about that. But I can at least see why it does appeal to people and understand that. And I think that's really cool that we could get someone on here that really does have a personal connection to Kanon to talk about it. So thank you very much for being on this podcast, Kanon. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much for making this podcast. I've given you hell for what?
You have.
A year and a half? More?
We finally did it, guys. We got Kanon done.
We finally got the time to do it. And I think this book club, these podcasts, have been a pretty good success.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you guys think so?
Yeah. We've had lots of, like, very in-depth discussion on the forum. And lots of people getting into it. And even quite a bit of fan art. I was really happy about that. Yeah, so shout outs to everyone who's contributed something. So I guess we should like do the usual thing and talk about our top posters for this route. So we have Aizen Kobu, Takafumi, Sonic 112003, The Rational Pie,
11-2003,
Kanon, and Magaska. You guys have all made awesome contributions, like not just in this particular route, but throughout the book club. And fan art wise, so we also had the Bionic. Posted a photo of a metal Ayu backpack.
Yes, it's metal.
Metalcraft. I don't know what you'd call that. A print? I don't think that's the right word. Either way, it's a metal Ayu backpack. And we also have Black Hayate has submitted her final entry in her little collection of portraits, I guess you could call them. And this one has the subtitle, Sweetfish. Thank you so much, Black Karate, for your contributions for this book club. It's been really appreciated. Especially, like, the consistency there. It's really cool.
Consistency? Comparing to Kanon's consistency?
Uh-huh. And how?
It's almost sunset.
She got the sunset colours in that fan art too, so way to go.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah, so, and now I guess we need to talk about something. And that is the MVP, the most valued poster. We haven't drawn much attention to this book club because we don't really have a lot of prizes lined up. So we thought we'd just do it kind of covertly.
Unfortunately.
We have a little thing.
There isn't much Kanon-related merchandise to give off as prizes. We've tried looking.
We have a little prize pack for you, so you can look forward to that. But it's nothing like huge like the Clannad prize pack. So don't get your hopes up too much, but you'll get a forum badge out of it. So... first off, I'll lay out the candidates. So that's Aizen Kobu, Magaska, The Rational Pi, and Kanon. All four of you
guys
have, like, yeah, two of you are right here right now. All four of you have done tremendous contributions to this book club. In every route, you guys have had, like, an awesome post, or many, like, just interacting with others. I know Kanon, like, was sharing his, like, dot point notes on each route, which was really fun to read. Magaska had huge essays. I guess Magaska, Aizen, and Pi all had huge essays just on everything that you could think about on the roots. I know Pi in particular had a lot of like sort of meta-analysis where it's like, what can we kind of like, how can we think of canon relating to our own lives and sort of the messages that sort of it brings home there, and I thought that was particularly interesting. And then we also had like Magaska and Aizen were especially active on the forums in terms of actively pushing forward discussion and, you know, back and forth communication there. And so I really appreciate that. But in the end, we have decided for the MVP is Aizen Kobu. Congratulations, buddy.
Hey,
sorry, Kanon and Pi.
I was all ready to just arm wrestle Kanon to see which one of us would get it.
Aizen, he tied me over because, unlike the other contributors, he did fan art. He did like a rap video and fan fiction.
That was so corny, but it was so good.
So I think that just about wins him over. And his posts were awesome. He was like right on top of this discussion. I know like he really wanted to be on the podcast, but we didn't have time to fit him in the schedule this time around. But Aizen, if you're listening to this, congratulations, buddy. I think you've deserved it. So
I remember when Aizen first joined, his avatar was IU, and he was super excited to be able to discuss Kanon, which he just read. Like, since then, he's read everything else, but I think Kanon holds a very big place in his heart. I'm not sure if it's as important to Kanon. Kun?
Hello. I'll fight him for that.
As important as to Kanon-kun, or as important as Kanon-kun finds it?
Yeah. But,
as important as Kanon-kun is to Aizen.
Oh,
we're getting to a different territory here.
Stop shipping my members. Yeah, so I guess that about wraps up the Kanon Book Club, guys. It's gonna be very sad. This is like the part. This is a sunset here where Yakusoku is playing, and we have to part.
Well. The ending will still be Kazu no Tadori Tsukubasho, so you can be happy with these memories of the Kanon Book Club.
Yeah,
should never forget.
No regrets.
We should continue smiling.
Mm-hmm.
No last regrets.
Mm-hmm. I hope that was a cheesy enough ending.
It was pretty good. And I guess I'll just leave you guys with a teaser. Coming soon, the Tomorrow After Book Club. I look forward to finally discussing this game with you guys. See you around, guys.
Goo.
I don't like people who say such things.